Joined by one of our favorite members of the United States Senate, United States Senator Jim Inhofe of Oklahoma. Good morning, Senator. I understand you're at the airport. You got a family emergency. I appreciate your taking your time. Our prayers with you and your family.
Hey, appreciate that very much, Hugh. You got lots of things happening right now.
All right, let's focus on the Senate trial. I just talked to Tom Cotton. The issue of witnesses is on my mind. If the House managers move for a witness, my question to you is, will the Senate GOP guarantee that the president gets a witness as well as the right to move for a witness? In other words, is there going to be due process for the president?
Yes, there will be due process for the president. And I have to say that Mr. McConnell has done a great job at putting this whole thing together and holding his cool while all the demands have been made of him. But he's going to make sure that this goes in an order. If she sends him over on Wednesday, which she's talking about doing, then on Tuesday, before we do any swearing in or anything else, or I should say on Thursday, McConnell, he has to have the resolution in hand. He has to know what the rules are. And we have to know who the impeachment managers are going to be. And then they'll start the next process, would be the Democrats' opening statement. Then, of course, the president and his team are going to be there. So it's all right now lined up as it should be. And it looks to me, and I would just predict, and I don't know what our previous guest said, but I think it's going to be probably Tuesday as opposed to this coming Thursday.
And how long, Senator Cotton did not make a prediction on when it would begin. How long do you expect it to last, Senator Inhofe?
You know, we didn't guess. I was around during the Bill Clinton impeachment, and we never realized it was going to be 5 weeks. I think it ended up being 4.5 weeks. This could last that long. It could last. The judge is going to have a lot to say about that. You got to keep in mind that's Judge Roberts, the presiding judge, and he'll have to make some of those decisions. Now, you have to keep in mind, and I'm sure that others have told you this, that if 51 senators vote, they could actually vote for a conclusion and end the whole thing. That's a possibility. We'll have to wait and see. That's up in the air now.
Now, the 51 senators do control the rules, thanks especially to Harry Reid and the nuclear option vis-a-vis judges a few years ago. And Mitch McConnell has used that, and the nuclear option is out there to change not just the rules of the Senate, but also the rules of the impeachment, different sets of rules. My question is your sense of fairness and on witnesses. Democrats are clamoring for Ambassador Bolton. I think they're going to grab the sharp end of a knife if they do that. But if they call him, I think the president gets to call a witness, whoever he wants, and if they are the first movers for witnesses, I think the president gets to be the option of being the first mover for the caller of a second round of witnesses. Have you guys discussed this yet?
Okay, Hugh, and you're exactly right, but we don't know yet because we don't know the rules, and we don't know what the rules are going to be accepted. And so I think we're getting that cart before the horse. I think we have to, first of all, get the resolution. We have to know what the rules are going to be, and have to know who the impeachment officers are. So which happens first is something we don't have control over, but that's the desirable end.
Now, Senator, there are press reports, and I trust press reports as far as I can throw them, but there are press reports that four members of the Republican caucus favor calling Ambassador Bolton. Now, they're all four fine people, and I know Governor, now Senator Romney, pretty well. He's a man deeply committed to fairness, and I think Senator Collins is as well. She voted for Brett Kavanaugh when all the pressure was on her not to do that. So I have confidence in the Senate Republicans, but can you imagine any scenario where John Bolton is the only witness called?
You know, I really can't, and I don't think you could. Susan Collins, yeah, I'm glad you said what you said about her. And she was being very fair. She measures things out. She's from Maine. That tells you a lot, right?
Yes,
there.
Yes, it does.
I don't think we're going to have I can't imagine other members coming in terms of witnesses. And, of course, I disagree with them. I don't think we need to have John Bolton. John Bolton is one of my closest personal friends. The whole thing's pretty distasteful, what happened. But nonetheless, I don't think we need that, the witnesses.
Yeah, if they call Ambassador Bolton, I've been describing it as grabbing a sharp knife at the wrong end. They're going to end up, you're going to end up with a lecture on how Crimea ended up part of Russia and not Ukraine.
You're right. You're right. And believe me, he was there and I was there one time with him. And I can tell you almost how that lecture would go out.
So
they're making a mistake if they think they can take care of him.
Now, do you believe as well that your colleagues, Bernie Sanders, Elizabeth Warren, and Amy Klobuchar, who are trying to get the nomination to run against President Trump, are going to enjoy sitting in their chairs for what could be 5, 6, 7 weeks?
Well, I don't think they're having a lot of fun right now as it is. I've never seen a situation like this. Here's the thing that you don't notice that other people don't notice, and that is, in their minds, the Democrats who are running right now, they're going to be debating, I guess, tonight. They all believe in their hearts that whoever's the Democrat nominee is automatically going to be president of the United States, which is garbage. Let me tell you, every time I see this president get out there and do the great work that he does, he's communicating directly with the people, not sitting in some sterile room in Washington, D.C., trying to decide who the nominee is going to be. So I think he's going to be the next president. I think we have other things that are happening right now that we're very much concerned with. I know you and I are both concerned with the 355 ship Navy.
Very much.
All these things that are going on right now. I've spoken to Modley, who was in my office last Thursday. We're all on in agreement on that. But I'd like to have people keep in mind, and this comes from me as the chairman of the Armed Services Committee, that we have the situation that we had under Obama. That is when the Iran appeared, and that was going to be something that was going to take care of in Syria. And it didn't happen. What happened with Soleimani was now all the world knows that a red line to America means action, and they're going to get action. And those days of the leftovers of Obama are behind us now.
I'm so happy to hear. If an American is killed or wounded, Donald Trump is going to act. And I like that red line.
You take him out. That's exactly right.
Can I talk to you about Secretary Modley for a second? Because I think he's doing a fantastic job. I read his vectors. I know he's the acting Secretary of the Navy. I know there's a nominee out there somewhere. But when you sit down with him, do you believe he is finally have a Secretary of the Navy who is committed to getting to 355? Because I just did not believe, Secretary Spencer's a fine guy. I just don't think he believed it.
Well, you got to keep in mind that the Trump's predecessor, Obama, he was really down to 280 or something like that. The specific number was never there. It's between 280 and 283. Modley is committed. He's looking at the confusion of this thing is when you talk about a 355 ship Navy, you have different types of things. You have and all those adjustments can be made, but the money. The problem that we have right now is that Obama, in the last 5 years of his administration, reduced the military by 25%. That's never happened before. And so we had to pick up the ball there and see how we divide this up. And we've done a great job since this president's been in for over 3 years now. We've rebuilt the military. Sure, the economy is great. I'm glad everybody knows that. It's due to this president. But also the military. That's the most important thing this president has done, is rebuild America. We allowed Obama for Russia and China to actually get ahead of us in many areas. And so we're just literally leaving America right now.
Last question, Senator Inhofe. I know you're waiting for a plane. The president has diverted another $7.5 billion from the Pentagon budget to build the fence. I'm all for that, by the way. I believe that that is an absolutely necessary, visible expression of an inward resolve to control our border. Do you think it hurts in any way any acquisition of importance to the military?
Well, it is important. And you're talking to the right person because I was a builder developer on that border down there for 25 years. I know the border. I also know that when our troops are down there, they're getting training that is better than their in-house training they get at home. And so this is taking place right now. And you got to keep in mind, we're not talking about Mexico. We're talking about terrorists coming across that border. And we are in a position to stop that now.
So you support the diversion of funds to build the wall?
Yeah, I do.
And does it in any way negatively impact the military? Because I don't think it does. I don't think we lose a ship. I don't think we lose a missile. I think we lose some facilities that would otherwise be built on bases.
The reason I say that, Hugh, is that they're getting a type of training. Those individuals down there are getting a training that's much more valuable than the training that they would get at port. And that's not, that value has to be considered, because we're going to spend X dollars on training in the military anyway. Let's do it where it's most effective. let's do it where we can do that and also solve the border problem.
Senator Inhofe, always a pleasure to talk with you, Mr. Chairman, and Godspeed to you. Prayers for your family. Look forward to talking to you soon.